I'm Pastor John. It's hard to express the joy I have in my heart right now for you that are searching for biblical truth all over the world, and you're experiencing its transforming power. I am so excited that you are seeking to grow in your faith and to put your faith into action. The best way for faith to grow is through partnership with a local church where you live. Now, you may be wondering what makes a good church that I should go to. Well, on our website, there's a link for you to connect with us. We'd be happy to help answer that question for you if you just send us an email and ask the questions that you have. And when you email us, we'd like to invite you to also include any prayer requests that you have. We have a great prayer ministry here at Calvary. We'd love our staff to rally around you and pray for whatever is on your heart. So include those requests in your email to us. And additionally, we would love to help you grow in your faith in Jesus Christ until you can get really connected to a local church. We desire that you become a disciple-making disciple of Jesus Christ. So when you contact us, let us know if you have any spiritual questions or if you need some Bible study materials. We'll try to furnish those to you. Now, let's pray as we open up God's Word and begin to study it. Father, we come before you right now knowing that you are the supreme teacher that will guide us into knowing truth. And we surrender to what you will teach us today in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, and let me take this opportunity to welcome you to Calvary. Thank you for being here. We are gathered to glorify the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Would you please stand this morning, and as people file in from the atrium and get comfortable, would you please welcome the people that are around you this morning? And sharing the love of Christ this morning. You can find your way back to your seat, and then you may have a seat as we get started this morning. My name is Pastor Josh, and I am the Family Life and Discipleship Pastor here at Calvary. I'm excited to see you and have you here. I'm excited to gather with you to worship Almighty God this morning. Let me start with just a few announcements to keep you up to date. If you got your connector as you came in this morning, this has dates and times and information for you. But we're going to highlight a few things. Coming up on August 13th is our Heritage Sunday. This is something new that we're doing because we want to remember the history of this church. And so August 13th is going to be a day dedicated to the legacy of this church. We are going to do church, if you want to call it that, like this church has done in the past. We're really excited for the music and for the preaching that day, and you'll get a taste of where this church has come from. So we're thankful for that. Make sure you're here August 13th. Also, you may notice in your connector is something called Seeds of Prayer. We encourage anyone who has anyone in school, if you have a kid, if you're a college student and you go to school, we want you to fill this out with this information and turn it in at the Connecting Center. There's a basket. And this is so that we can have a prayer ministry for you throughout the year. We know school can be tricky and difficult, and new prayer requests arise throughout the year, and we want people to pray for you. There'll be an opportunity later on Labor Day weekend to pick up a name that you will commit to praying for the whole school year. You can take one, two, three names, whatever you want to do, but we want to cover anyone who's in school in prayer. This sweet hour of prayer will be a women's event that will be dedicated that night, August 29th, to praying for the upcoming school year and students. So ladies, make sure you mark that on your calendar as we seek to pray for everyone in school. Also, ladies, don't forget the women's camping weekend is coming up August 18th and 19th. If you are a part of that ministry or a part of that event at all, or you're interested, there is a meeting August 2nd at 7 p.m. Would you please mark your calendars and come to that meeting for just information? It'll give you details about food and timing and all of that if you want to be a part of that. So August 2nd at 7 p.m. Also coming up is one of our Crave meals. This is like a good old-fashioned potluck, but we call it a Crave meal. This one is specific to anyone who is volunteering in our Awana ministry coming up in the fall, or any of our KidsLink volunteers. KidsLink is our children's ministry here at Calvary. It includes our Sunday school hour, our nursery, our during the service hour and ministries. So if you are a KidsLink volunteer or an Awana volunteer coming up for the fall, we ask you to stay after church on August 27th. Make sure you bring a main dish and a salad or a dessert to pass, and we're going to have a time of training. It's not going to last all day, but we encourage you to be here for that. Also coming up, if you love to have outdoor activities, you love to golf, the Chippewa Valley Golfing Church Association, I guess I'm rambling, but there's a poster out there that explains it. All churches are invited for you to come and be a part of this golf tournament. It's going to be at Lake Wasota Golf Course, August 19th and 20th. For more information, check out the Connecting Center. There's a poster out there. There's a lot of other information out there, like how to get connected to life groups and different brochures for all the ministries we offer here. Please stay connected by visiting those areas and checking out those ministries. Would you all please take this opportunity to stand as we enter into our time of call to worship?
Good morning.
Whoa.
Good morning. Welcome. Today we focus in our sermon series for the summer on redeeming love. We focus on an aspect of redemption that is very personal to all of us, and that is, how do we redeem the time that God has given us here on this earth? And I want to read to you from Hosea chapter 10, verse 12, one verse. Sow for yourselves righteousness. Reap steadfast love. Break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord, that he may come and rain righteousness upon you. Let's pray. Our Father, we have developed fields in the compartments of our lives that are unplowed. We've asked them to be left alone. We've asked you to not bother us with them, because there are little private places. It is time, in redeeming the time, to seek the Lord and to break up your unplowed, fallow ground, and to sow seeds of righteousness so a harvest of righteousness can be showered upon us bountifully by a gracious God. We pray that today we will understand that all of our time is really your time for your purpose. And as we worship today in song, in giving, in praying, and in hearing from you, let us remember that it is all yours. All of our resources, all of our energy, all of our plans, all of our time is yours. And let us today give it all to you if we are holding anything back. And we pray this, Jesus, in your name. Amen.
Good morning, church. Good morning, church. You guys ready to sing your praise. Come on. Put your hands together for us. Yeah. All right, you guys know this, so sing it out. Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. And everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior. The hope of nations. Every tribe, every tongue, every nation, lift your praise. Come on, church. Everything I believe in, right here, right now, Lord, I surrender. Lord, with open hands, lift it high, we surrender to you. Here we go. With your voices, sir, shine your light. Come on. Church, come on, Savior.
Share with you a quick testimony that I heard this morning, and I'll keep it brief. I was listening to a broadcast this morning, and a Christian comedian was on, and she was sharing about her childhood and about how she had a pastor who was a dad, her dad was a pastor, and he was very inconsistent. During the week was manic depressive and had suicidal thoughts, and she was sharing how that affected her upbringing and her definition of God. And when asked what her recommendation was for parents, she said, make sure that who you are on Sunday is who you are the rest of the week. And I was thinking about that and how we tend to let the rest of the week determine what we do on Sunday. And specifically, I was convicted with giving. Do I let the rest of my week, the bills, the everything else, declare what I do on Sunday when I give? We have an opportunity this morning to shout to declare that the mountains aren't too big for God to move. And we have the ability to declare that today to the rest of our week, not let the rest of our week declare that today. So as you gather, as you bow in prayer, as we receive the offerings this morning, are you telling God how much you love him today and then letting the rest of the week fall into place because of that truth? Or are we letting the rest of the week affect our worship today? Let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning and we declare that you can move the mountains. And each one of us has a mountain or multiple mountains in our lives that we think are just too big. God, one of the biggest topics in a marriage and in a family is finances. And it is so easy to try to make our own way with what we have been given, instead of allowing your way to be done. So this morning we commit, we declare that no matter what's in front of us, whether it's a huge bill that we just can't get our heads around, whether it's debt, whether it's just faith that you will provide day to day, Lord, we declare that you can move those mountains. And we tell the rest of our circumstances and the rest of our week that you are God, Almighty God, who created the mountains and can move them with no effort. We love you, Lord, and we want our lives to reflect that. Would you please take these generous offerings this morning and multiply them so that you can be glorified, so that your work can be done, not our own. And would you give wisdom to the people that are in charge of those finances, the people at this church who decide what ministries to invest in? Would you make it clear what we are supposed to do? Because we want it to be all about you, God. You are an awesome God. We praise you for giving us your son, Jesus. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. As the ushers are receiving the offerings, I would like Josh Melder, who is part of our AIM team, our missions team here at Calvary, to introduce to you someone that we're going to get an update from this morning.
Good morning, Calvary. Today we have the privilege of having Logan and Lauren Corton back with us today, and they are currently missionaries at Stevens Point, Wisconsin with InterVarsity, so they're going to give us a brief update on how they're doing.
Well, thanks for having us. We're excited to be back. It's been a few years since we've been here. But we first want to begin by saying thank you for praying for us, for financially supporting us as a church, and then also we just moved, and that's part of what we'll share about, but your church sent us a moving team to help us pack up our truck, and it was such a blessing. They literally had everything in the truck before I even knew what happened, and so it was a huge blessing to have you guys support us in many ways. We wanted to share a little bit about what God's been doing in our family and in our ministry. I was on staff here at Eau Claire for 4 years with InterVarsity, and Lauren has been on staff for 7 years. We've been in a huge season of transition. We have a three-month-old at home, and we moved 2.5 months ago. So we had a baby, and 2 weeks later packed up a truck. And so it's been a lot in our life and a lot in our family, but it's all really good, and the Lord is even affirming the move. So like he said, we now work at the University of Wisconsin, Stevens Point, so only a couple hours from here. But just wanted to share sort of how that happened. We've been at Eau Claire. Eau Claire still, even being back, still feels like home. But God sort of put it on our heart to start praying about what might he have in store for us, what might be the next step. And so even a year ago, we started praying about, is this where we want to be? If it is, Lord, affirm that Eau Claire is where you want us. And if you want us somewhere else, would you give us direction and guiding on where that is? Through the course of praying, even 6 months ago, we started being asked by different campuses to consider moving and praying towards that. And one of the campuses that we had originally thought of and saw that there would be staffing need was UWSP. And I'm originally from Stevens Point, and so hearing through the grapevine and through the church community there that there was going to be InterVarsity staffing needs, we started asking, like, God, could this be where you want us to go? And little did we know, at the same time, on Stevens Point, on the Stevens Point end, they too were praying about who do we invite, and our name came up. And so it was just affirming knowing that the Lord was moving even before we knew what was going to happen, that we were being pursued by the campus that we were praying about potentially going to. And it's been a blessing going there. At Eau Claire, we've had an abundance of staff. We were two of seven staff here on campus. And this coming year, we will be two of three. So they have quite a bit of need at Stevens Point. It's a similar campus if you've ever been to Stevens Point. Both campuses are anywhere between 10 and 11,000 students. And the chapter at UWSP is right around 100 to 150 students. So our prayer is that that'll continue to grow. They have a bunch of international students involved, which my wife Lauren works with, which she can give more of an update about too. But we're just thankful that God has been guiding us. And I mean, even like Pastor said, he is powerful and is sovereign and faithful in leading us and guiding us. So we're excited about this next stage and how God has sort of shown us little pieces of the puzzle a little bit at a time. And now we can finally see the whole puzzle piece and where he's wanting us to be. So thanks for being a supportive church in that.
So some of you are probably aware of Doon and Begong and their ministry to Chinese people as well as international students. And these last 2 years, I've been able to personally partner with them in reaching international students at UW-Eau Claire and providing a community for the students to come and feel cared for as well as learn about Jesus. And we did that through regular meals, which your church provided, which was a huge blessing. And from that, I was able to personally learn even more how to minister to international students. So I'm very excited to go to UW Stevens Point and continue doing the same thing. We found out that they have an event called Tea and Talk on Friday nights where the international students gather and make a meal together, and then they have a Bible study after. And so we are both very excited to join in on that and learn more about how we can support that ministry. Next week, actually, I'm going to be meeting with a Christian professor who works in the Center for International Education to learn more about the culture of the international students and where there's need and how to get them connected to church and so forth. So as we're standing up here giving an update, it's kind of funny because we don't really know a lot to share with you as far as specifics because we've only been in Stevens Point for 2 months, but we're excited to hopefully come back maybe next year and be able to tell you more specifically what's happening as well as how the Lord has worked through us and through the people that we get to join with. We just wanted to invite you to be praying for us as we make this transition. Pray for us as we continue to learn more about our new roles and how we can be used on the campus, as well as for our family as we continue to settle into our new home and for our two boys as they settle into a new environment that we'll find friends and as we get to connect with our church there. And lastly, we would love to meet you. If you've never met us, please come on back outside after the service, and we'd love to say hi and get to know you more. And we do have more information if you'd like to know more about our ministry. So, thank you.
Let's pray for the Cortons real quick, guys. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for raising up Logan and Lauren to go to Stevens Point, Lord, and just to reach the students for you. Lord, I pray that you would just go before them, prepare the hearts of these students, help them to just be willing to accept the gospel and help their ministry grow. Lord, help them as they adjust to living in a new location, help their children to adjust, and just help them to keep looking for you in all things. In Jesus' name.
My soul, remember redemption's healed where your blood was spilled for my ransom. Everything I once held dear, it is, I count it all as lost. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Lord, lead me. lead me to the cross. But you were as I attempted and tried. Yes, you were. You the Word became flesh, bore my sin and death. Now you're risen. Yes, you are. Everything, everything I wanted here, I count it all as lost. Lead me to the cross. Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself. I belong to you. Lord, lead me. Lead me to the cross. Lord, to your heart. To your heart. To your heart. I belong to you, Lord, lead me, lead me to the cross. Oh, rid me of myself, Father. I belong, and everything that is belongs to you. Oh, lead me to the cross. Lead me to the cross. Let this be our, all my delights. All my delights are in you, Lord. All my hope, all of my hope, all of my strength. All my delights are in you, Lord, forevermore. Oh, hear our prayer, Lord, we declare. All our delight is in you, Lord. All of my hope, all of my strength, all my delight is in you, Lord, forevermore.
Father, if that's not our prayer, if that's not the true cry of our heart, there is no way that we can faithfully live out your redeeming love. We can say we understand redeeming love, but we have not been bought back. We have not been redeemed if we still hold on to that which was supposed to have died so we could fully experience the life of Jesus Christ. So in the quietness of this moment right now, can we truly say, all my delight is in you. All my life is in you. There is no thing, there is no pursuit, there is nothing of this world of such value that it cannot be surrendered so that we find all of our delight in you alone. Take that before the Lord right now and then join with
the team as we sing that one more time as the honest prayer of our hearts today. Live out that redeeming love every day with a focus on eternity, redeeming the time. May our hearts be receptive to your word today in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Well, today we have a special guest with us. As the children are leaving, let me just tell you a little bit about him and his ministry. And he is going to speak to us today. Some of you are probably familiar with him from his radio program on WHEM Radio. His name is Rick Grubbs. Rick is a former professor of public speaking who now serves as a full-time Christian seminar leader and conference speaker. He's president of an organization called Life Changing Seminars, and he hosts the Redeeming the Time 1 Minute Radio program. Prior to founding Life Changing Seminars, Rick and Carrie served as missionaries to Czechoslovakia, and he also served as a prison chaplain. He's spoken over 1,000 times on the subject of time in 49 of the 50 states, and he's writing for Christian periodicals that have a circulation of 1.4 million readers. His wife, Carrie, is a stay-at-home mom and stays busy assisting in the work. Rick and Carrie have been married for 26 years. They live in Salisbury, North Carolina, and they have 12 children and one grandchild. 8 of the children are with them here today, and they're going to bless us to begin this morning with a song. Rick.
Amen. Well, we are happy to be with you today, and as Pastor John's already mentioned, we've got 8 of the 12 with us, and we're just going to go ahead and start off with a song from them right now.
Solid rock. I'm standing on the rock. solid rock. I'm standing on the solid rock.
Glory. Amen. Good. I am glad for that rock today. Glad I'm standing on him, aren't you? Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, kids, and my wife, Carrie, as well, for that song. And before they take off, they're going to help me with something before we begin the message today. We want to make sure that everybody has a couple of things. We want to make sure that everybody got one of these little packets as you came in today. If we happen to miss you, the kids are going to go up and down these two side aisles right here and give you one. We want everybody to have one. Husband needs one. Wife needs a separate one. If you don't have your own, make sure you get one of these. Also, you're going to need something to write with, and some of the kids have bags of pencils. They're going to circulate around for the next few minutes and make sure that everybody has something to write with as well. Since it's my first time here, let me just take a few moments to explain why I like to give you that material. People only remember about 20% of what they hear. If you just sit and listen, you'll forget 80% of everything I talk about by the time we go home today. But when you see it, you hear it, you write it down, 65%, three times as much. So what you want to do is open your packet, look inside. You'll find an outline of this morning's message on redeeming the time, as Pastor said. Everybody find that piece of paper right there. I'm going to put the answers to the outline on the screens, and I'm going to encourage you to be an active participant in the message today by taking those notes. How many going to do that for me? How many going to take those notes and participate? Good, good. That looks excellent. Very good. Well, the boys are just going to continue to pass that out. Let them know what you need, but we're just going to go ahead and get started by looking at a verse of Scripture that talks about redeeming. It's found in Ephesians chapter 5. I'm just going to quote verse 16 for you today instead of reading the whole passage. Ephesians 5:16 gives us a very important command having to do with redemption, where the Apostle Paul is giving us a command to be redeeming the time. So why don't we pray before we go any further with the message, and let's just ask God if he'd be pleased to help us today to understand what that means to redeem the time and how we can do that. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I do want to pray that you would shut us in for the next few minutes as we think about our time, how you would have us to redeem that time. And Lord, would you show us today any areas where we're missing your best because we're not redeeming the time. And I pray, Lord, that you would send us home today a people more committed, more determined than ever, that we're going to redeem the time. For Jesus' sake we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, let's start by defining what we mean by this phrase, redeeming the time. Got two words there, redeem and time. What does it mean to redeem something? Well, I think you've been talking about that here around the church for a while. Let me give you a definition I like. To redeem something means to rescue it from going to waste. If you're taking the notes, right there's where you start, beside the word redeem, write it down, to rescue from going to waste. Now, I like starting off with that word because to me, that's a very beautiful word because it's a word that also tells us what Jesus Christ did for you and for me. When he went to the cross, he did it to redeem us. He did that to rescue us from going to waste. There was a time in my life when I hadn't been redeemed. I was a 19-year-old college student, just caught up in the party scene at a state university, living for the weekend until a couple of Christians came into my life, and I appreciate those folks that were just here from InterVarsity because one of those guys was the president of our local InterVarsity chapter at Appalachian State University. He took an interest in me. He began witnessing to me, telling me how I could know I'd go to heaven when I died, and you know what? I saw something in those guys from InterVarsity that I didn't have in my own life. And I started to hunger after that until one night I got alone in my room. I started crying out to God. I remembered a verse of Scripture I learned that said, "Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." And that's what God did. He saved me. He redeemed me. He rescued me from going to waste. Praise his name. And that's been over 30 years ago, but I'm still glad to be redeemed today. How about you? Amen. Amen. And now that's what God says he wants us to do with our time. He says, I want you to rescue it from going to waste. Okay, now that was pretty easy to stick a definition on, but our second word is the word time. Now, if I ask you the question, what time is it? You're going to say coming up on 11. But if I switch the word order around and I say time, what is it? That's a little more difficult, right? We all know what time is, but if I say explain it, somebody, give me a definition for that word. Well, Rick, that's a little harder. Let me give you a definition I like, though. I like this definition because the man who gave it to us demonstrated with his own life an unusually good understanding of time, and I can say that because of all this man was able to accomplish in one lifetime. When I say his name, you're going to remember him as being one of the founding fathers of our country. He was a great statesman, diplomat, an ambassador to other countries as well, but he was also a great inventor. He invented bifocal glasses, somebody's probably wearing here today. He invented our modern design for a school desk where we sit in a chair, the desktop being attached to one arm of the chair. He was the first to think of that. He also invented the rocking chair and the lightning rod because he was a scientist. He was the first one to discover that electricity has a positive and a negative side to it. A successful businessman. He started an insurance company, among other things. He was an author, printer, and publisher. He started Saturday Evening Post and Poor Richard's Almanac, still in print 200 years later. He started a hospital, first postmaster general of the United States, one of the first to think of daylight savings time. The list keeps going on and on. Who am I talking about? Say it out loud if you know it. Benjamin Franklin, exactly. Now, would you agree with me that Benjamin Franklin accomplished more with his one lifetime than most of us would do with a thousand lifetimes? That's because of his understanding of time. He once said this. He said, "Do you love life?" He said, "Then don't waste your time, because that is what life is made of." Benjamin Franklin experienced such unusual accomplishment because he understood that time is the passing of life. Time is the passing of life. And so if you waste your time, what are you ultimately wasting? Someone tell me. Your life, exactly. Now, if I say, "Hey, anybody here plan on wasting your life?" Nobody would raise your hand. It's a silly question. But if I were to say, "How many of us will likely waste a little bit of time this next week?" You know what? I believe everybody in the room would have to be guilty to some degree. And that reveals a tactic of the devil. He tries to make us think that somehow there is a difference between time on the one hand and life itself on the other. Because if he can do that, the result is going to be that I won't properly value my time. I won't see it as life. And so I waste a minute of it. Now, let's say that happens 60 times during my day. I just wasted an hour. 24 of those slipped by. A day has gone unredeemed. That turns into a week, a month, maybe a year passes. I do nothing significant for God with my time until, unfortunately, what will happen in many of our lives is we'll simply drift in and out of the different seasons of our life, never really taking hold for God with our time as we should, until one day we wake up as an old man or an old woman, looking back on life frustrated and thinking, "Where did it go? What happened to all those things I wanted to do for God as a young person?" And we didn't understand that as we were wasting our time, hey, we were really wasting our life, because a wasted life, the most tragic thing I know of, is simply an accumulation of a lot of wasted time. Does everybody see how that works? Now, nobody here wants to wake up someday with the tragedy of a wasted life behind you. So what we're going to do now is look at what God has to say about why it is so important that we learn to redeem the time God has given us. And just to let you know where I'm going, I'm going to spend most of my time on these next three points. The rest of it will go very quickly after that. But let's look at these reasons why we want to redeem the time. Number one, our time is limited. Whenever you have a limited resource, you got to be careful how you use it. Let me just kind of demonstrate what I mean. I want to see your hand if there's ever been a time in your life you found yourself tight on money. Does that happen in Wisconsin? Oh, okay, happens in North Carolina, where I'm from, too. Think back to the last time things were a little tight financially at your house and you got hungry. Did you take a trip over to Minneapolis, find the most expensive restaurant in town, and throw them down a $100 bill? Is that what you do? No. You stay home. You eat some beans, some rice, because you realize that money's in limited supply and you got to be careful how you spend it, right? Okay, God wants us to develop that kind of an attitude towards time, because he said it is also in limited supply. He tells us in the Bible exactly how limited it is likely to be. In Psalm 90, he tells us that the average of a person's life is only going to be about 70 to 80 years. And folks, if we got nothing else out of our short time together today, I just want us to go home with a clearer picture in our minds of how short that 70 years actually is. To do that, I want you to look down at the bottom of the paper where you're taking your notes. You're going to see a little chart that looks like this one. I want you to think of this chart as being a picture of your life, and then place a mark on that chart wherever you find yourself. Let's say you're 35, you'd put your mark right here. Then go over to the left-hand side and start shading in between those two lines over to where you've just made your mark, like I've done here. And let's see if we can get everybody to do this. Even if you take no other notes today, do this one thing for me, because this will make a big difference if you'll just do this for me. I'm talking about that little graph right there across the bottom. Looks like we're getting pretty good participation. Good, good, good. Fill that in. And as you fill in that little chart, I want you to consider, I mean, I want you to very carefully consider just how much time has already gone by, no matter where you find yourself at. Let's say you are 35. You might look at that chart and say, well, now, you know, Rick, that don't look so bad. I mean, I got another 35 to go. But let me show you why this chart might ought to get your attention. You see up here on the top side of the chart, there's a fraction. And by the time you reach 35, your fraction already says one half. What that means is if you live to be a 70-year-old, you've already used one half of that time by the time you're only 35. But there's another reason why this chart ought to get our attention, and it's what I call the snowball effect. You know, if you go up to the top of a snow-covered hill, make a little snowball and give it a push, as it goes down that hill, it's going to get bigger and bigger. But what else? It's going to go faster and faster, till when it reaches the bottom of this hill, you've got a very fast-moving object. And this is what time does, because anybody here ever notice how that the older you're getting, the faster time seems to go? I see a lot of folks kind of nodding their head yes. Let me explain why. You see, when you're 10 years old, your mom says to you, Johnny, you're going to have to wait one more year till Christmas to get that toy. In little Johnny's mind, he's thinking, a year, well, that's 10% of a lifetime, Mom. But 10 years later, by the time you're 20, one more year of training, well, that's only 5% of a lifetime. By the time you're 50, another year is only 2% of a lifetime. So our perspective on time changes as we age, each year appearing to go by faster and faster as that frame of reference changes. So the point here is simply this. If you're 35 years old today, that second 35 is going to fly by at a rate two or three or four times as quickly as the first half did. So the point of it is, whatever God has put me in this world to do, you know what? I got to get busy doing it. And whatever He's called you to do, you got to get busy doing it too, because look at your chart and you'll quickly realize that you just don't have unlimited time between right here and right here to do whatever you're going to do for God for all of eternity. Amen, church. Amen. Now, there's a second reason we want to redeem the time, and it really just kind of ties right into the first one. And that is that for every person in the room right now, death is certain. That means there is coming a time when you will simply have no more time. And I know that nobody's going to disagree with me on this point, but the problem is we always tend to think it's just going to happen to the other person out there. But the one in your seat this morning also has that appointment with death, like it or not. Let me illustrate this through a little fable about a young man who was home one day when he opened the door, and it was Death. And he said, oh, wait a minute, Death, I'm a young man. There's an old man across the street. Get him. He's had his life. I haven't. Well, amazingly, Death said, okay, I'll do that. And the next time I come back for you, I'll even give you a warning so you can get ready for me. Oh, that young man was relieved. And you know what? He kind of straightened his life up for a little while, like you'll do after a close encounter with Death, right? But as time went on, he sort of forgot about Death. As he went through his 20s, got him a good education. In his 30s, he began to raise him a nice family. In his 40s and 50s, he was climbing up that ladder of success, doing quite well, in fact, until one day he was an old man and no, Death, you didn't keep your promise. You told me you'd give me a warning so I could get ready. And Death said, just a moment, old man. He said, you remember that time when you were in your 20s and you had to get your first pair of glasses? He said, remember when you were in your 30s? You tried to play basketball with the young people and you started huffing and puffing and realizing you couldn't keep up anymore like you used to? He said, look at your face. Look at your hair. Those aren't features of a young man. They're features of an old man. I didn't give you one warning. I gave you a warning every day. You just wouldn't listen. Now you're going to come with me. And you know what, folks? There's a lot of truth in that little fable, isn't there? Because God is always sending us those little aches and pains and changes of our features and failures of our bodies as reminders. Time is winding up. It's running out. We don't have unlimited time. The the church bought us a nice hotel room here in town last night, and I went down to swim with the kids there in the pool, and after a few minutes, I was beat, and they still had all this energy, you know. It used to be the other way around, and I was the one in there swimming, showing them how to do it. Now they're showing me how to do it. But it's one of those little reversals that takes place as a reminder that time is running out. Time is winding up. Think about it this way. Remember when you were in high school? First day of the new school year, your teacher started by saying, "Listen up, everybody. I'm giving you an important assignment right now, and it's going to be due when we go home for Christmas on December the 20th. Okay, somebody tell me, when did you really get busy working on that paper that was due December 20th? Somebody tell me. December 19th, exactly. Because what happened December 19th? You said, "Oh no, I got a deadline coming." And at that point, you got busy doing what you should have been doing back in September, right? Okay, God said life operates on this same principle. He says in the Bible, "It is appointed unto men once to what?" Anyone know? Die. And after this, the judgment, the final examination, if you will. Think back to high school again. Wouldn't you have done a lot better on that day of final examination if you started preparing for it back in September when they first gave you the warning that it was coming? And that's why God says, remember your Creator while you're still young, before you get to the end times. The principle here is simply this. The earlier in life I establish it in my thinking that I'm operating here under a deadline, the wiser I'll be in the way I spend my time every day. But there is another reason to redeem the time, and this one is the most important of all, because you know what? In another sense, death really isn't the end of time. It's just the last chapter of time as we know it now. It is the first chapter of a different form of time we call eternity. And the main reason we want to redeem the time is because the way we use our time today is going to have consequences for all of eternity. Galatians 6:7 teaches us that whatever a man sows, he will also reap. That means that what I do with my time today will bring consequences in my future. Nothing difficult about that. If I go to work today, I get paid tomorrow. If I'm lazy today, I go hungry tomorrow. The problem is when we try to apply that same principle to this word right here, eternal. Would you underline this word on your paper? Because here's where the problem comes. You see, we tend to think through this process of sowing and reaping only to the point of death, if we even think that far ahead. But the problem with that thinking is that death is not where the consequences of how I've spent my time are going to end. Folks, that death is where the real consequences of how we spend our time today are all going to begin to unfold. Because you can actually think of all of time in this world right now as planting. We're sowing. And then all of eternity, you and I are going to be reaping back the consequences of what we chose to plant during this short little season of time. But the problem is that in order for me to make that connection between how I'm spending my time today and what I'm going to produce in eternity, I've got to be able to picture eternity. You can't relate to something you can't picture. And as I began to struggle with that problem a while back, I said, "Lord, is there some way that I could give people a picture of eternity in a way they could see it and get a handle on it to really understand the significance of it?" And so I tried to find the largest number anyone had ever officially named. One of the numbers I found was this one. It's called 10 duotrigontillion. Now, this is a 1 followed by 100 zeros, 10 to the 100th power. I think everybody would agree that's a big number, right? But let me just take a moment to kind of explain for you how big this number actually is. Now, probably the biggest number we could actually use in real life would be the one that talks about our national debt. Right now, our U.S. government owes in the trillions of dollars. Let's see what a trillion of something looks like. Okay, there's 10, there's 10,000, there's 10 million, 10 billion, 10 trillion. So right there would be the largest number we could actually use. We're not even off the first line. Let me give you a better illustration. A while back, I was in the state of New York sharing this. A man came up after the meeting and said, "I'm a math professor at the local college. We've tried to calculate the number of atoms in the entire known universe. We estimate it's about a 1 followed by 85 zeros. That would bring us to right here. So this number, 10 to a trigontillion, is so enormous, you can't even use it, because there's not 10 duotrigontillion of anything, as far as we can tell. There is actually only one possible application which I could see for this number, and that is this. 10 duotrigintillion years from today, you know what? You're still going to be somewhere. Isn't that right? You're still going to be doing something, feeling something, experiencing something somewhere 10 duotrigintillion years from this Sunday morning. Think about that for a minute, would you? I mean, just see if you can let your mind dwell on that long enough to grasp the importance of what we're talking about. And if you can, and if you're a Christian today, then that, my friend, ought to be the most wonderful thought you could ever entertain. Because what this is really saying is you're going to be with the Lord Jesus Christ. The one we're here to worship today is going to take you to heaven. And you'll go to heaven and you'll worship Him there. You'll praise Him there. You'll give Him glory and honor and praise. You know, it's not just for the next 10,000 years, like when we sing the song Amazing Grace, and it says, when we've been there 10,000 years, like that's a long time. Well, we really have just begun, because you got 10 duotrigintillion more to worship and praise our God. And I tell you what, when I think of how good He's been to me for 30-some years now that I've served Him, I'm looking forward to that next 10 duotrigintillion. How about you? Amen? Amen. And I praise Him today that that's a settled issue in my life. I'm glad I know where I'm going. I'm glad I know what I'm going to be doing for the next 10 duotrigintillion years and beyond, because that's not eternity. That's only the beginning of eternity. Praise His name. Aren't you glad for Jesus? Aren't you glad to be redeemed today? Amen. But you know, my friends, I really would not be reminding you of all the truth on this point if I didn't remind you that while it is the most wonderful thought for us as Christians, the Bible is very clear that not everybody will go to heaven, and it's equally the most tragic thought for those who die unprepared to meet God. It makes me think of the words of a British skeptic, a man who didn't even believe in God, who once said to a Christian, "You Christians, you don't really believe the Bible." Now, he said, "If I actually believed for one moment that there was a place as horrible as what Jesus Christ described hell as being, a place of torment, a place described as a lake of fire," he said, if I really believed that people were going there and they were going to spend forever there, he said, "I would get on my hands and my knees. I would crawl on broken glass all across my country just to warn one person about a place like that." But he said, "I don't see you doing that, and you don't really believe that Bible either." And you know, when I think of that again this morning, I just want to say, God, please help me. Help me to redeem my time. Help me to live my life in such a way that it looks like I really do believe what's in this book. Even the parts that are not so pleasant, the parts that are not so popular to talk about today, but they're still in the book. And help me to live my life, use my time in such a way that it looks like I really do believe this book. That's my prayer today, that God would seal that thought to our mind and that we can use our time to prepare ourselves and others for the next 10 duotrigintillion and beyond. Amen. Amen. There's another vital reason for us to redeem the time, and that is that time can never be recovered. That's simply the nature of time. We're going to use it or we're going to lose it. James in Scripture said, "What is your life? It's a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away." I think about this in connection with Psalm 90, where the writer says, "Lord, teach us to number our days that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom." What does that really mean, though, to number my days? Well, think of it this way. There's going to come a point in many of our lives, if we live long enough, where we no longer think about our life in terms of how far we have come. Rather, we start thinking of life in terms of how far we probably have left to go. What that means is your reference point changes from the beginning of life to the end of life. We no longer look backwards and say, "How many birthdays have I had?" We start looking the other direction and thinking, "You know, how many more birthdays will I probably have?" We don't see time as something we accumulate, getting more of. We see it as something we're using up, something we have less of with each passing day. That's what God means when He says, "Number our days," to put a number here on the remaining days so we apply our hearts unto wisdom. Problem is, the research will tell us that most people do not clearly make that change until they're already right here where I am, in their 50s. But the earlier in life we could train ourselves to think forward instead of backwards, the wiser we would be in the way we'd choose to spend that time each day. Let me give you one more reason why we want to redeem the time, and that is that time is the most valuable thing you and I own. It is our most valuable earthly possession. And again, if we live long enough, someday many of us will realize this. Problem is, we often don't catch on until it's too late. Best example from history was Queen Elizabeth I of England, richest person in the world in her day. She was like the Bill Gates of her era. She had everything money could buy. Actually, I heard this last week. Jeff Bezos has passed Bill Gates now, so I guess I got to change that a little bit. But she was the richest person in the world in her day. And yet, when it came time for Queen Elizabeth to die, here's the last word she ever spoke from her deathbed. She said, "I would give all my kingdom for one more moment of time." Yeah, she understood the value of time, but she understood it too late. Those are some reasons to redeem the time. I'm going to have to skip a couple of points there on your outline in order to get done on time today. So let's just go ahead and look at some specific ways we can go home today better prepared to redeem the time that God has given us. Number one, good starting place for many of us tomorrow morning would just be learning how to wake up and get up. Now, I'm going to confess, this isn't always easy for me to stand up and preach about because it isn't always easy for me to do myself. But I have noticed something, and that is that my devotional life is going to rise or fall based on my ability to consistently get up on time and spend that morning time with God. Now, I did something a while back that helped me out, might help you if you try it. I used to have a little alarm clock with a button on the top called a snooze button. How many know how those work? Okay, then you know what would happen, don't you? Clock would go off, I'd smack it, fall back in bed. Smack it, fall back in bed. I'd go through that routine every morning as I counted through the Boeing numbers. You know, Boeing aircraft has a 727, then a 737, then it'd be 747, even 757. 8 o'clock, I'd throw my clothes on, rush out of the door, barely getting to work on time. Well, one day, I came across a scripture in Proverbs, and it said, "As the door turns on its hinges, boom, so does the lazy man on his bed." I said, "That's a picture of Rick Grubbs right there trying to get up, you know, like a door on the hinges rolling back and forth, getting in a wrestling match with my sheets and getting pinned." So I cut the wires to that snooze button, put it on the other side of the room, not beside my bed, so that when the clock went off, I had to get up, go across the room and shut that thing off, and I only got one opportunity to do it. By that time, I was up, and up is where I already determined the night before I had to be at that time if I was going to spend time with God. So remember, mind over mattress, and see if that won't help you get on up on time tomorrow morning. I want to give you something today. If you've ever had a struggle or know somebody who's ever had a struggle with getting up on time and spending their morning time with God, it's a little booklet we published called Learn How to Wake Up and Get Up. It's based on a message by a man named John Wesley, lived a couple hundred years ago. He was greatly used of God, and he said God was able to use him to such a degree because of his discipline of early rising. He made an entire sermon on the topic of how to know when to go to bed and how to know when to get up. I put that sermon into booklet form with a few of my own notes, and you can read this in about 15 minutes. It can make a profound difference in your life. How many people would like one of these if I give it to you free today? Let me see. Okay, that's what I figured. Just about everybody. Here's what you need to do. Look down in your packet. You'll find an envelope from our ministry. If you would like one of those, print your email as clearly as possible for me on that bottom line right there where it says email. You don't have to fill the rest of it out, but just print where it says email very clearly. Drop it off on our table back there on your way out, and we'll get you that book by email probably in a couple of weeks when we finish our trip. We're not going to spam you. We're not going to sell it to anybody else. We're not going to do anything bad with it. You have my promise on that, but we do have to have it to get you that resource. So be sure, put your email across there, drop it off on the table as you leave, and we would like to get you that free resource, Learn How to Wake Up and Get Up. I think I'm going to skip this next point and go to C on your outline, which is learning how to identify and then eliminate those things that waste our time. You see, the devil has three goals for your life. They're listed for us in John 10:10. He's come to steal, kill, and destroy. The devil is a thief, and thieves go after the most valuable thing they can get their hands on. What did we already establish as number one most valuable thing we own? Someone tell me. Our time, exactly. Now, the devil knows that, and so all day long, he sends into your life and mine little thieves to try to steal away that precious resource. But if you can identify a thief, you can protect the valuables and keep the theft from occurring. So the question is, how do you identify a thief of time? Answer, you ask two simple questions before you give your time to any activity. Number one, what's going to be the fruit, the result of this activity in 5 years? In the year 2022, is this going to make any difference if I do it or if I don't? And if the answer is, well, no, this won't make any difference in 2022, leave it alone. Find something else that will make a difference in 2022. You know, as I ask myself this question, I say, well, you know, what could I really do with my time today that's going to matter in 2022? You know, the first thing that comes to my mind? Well, you met them here just a few minutes ago. That is our 12 children. And, you know, if I could come back to your church 5 years from now and have the people on the screen there still wanting to serve God as they do today, do you know what I'll be at that time? I'll be a success. No matter what else does or does not happen, I'm going to be a success if my children turn out serving God. Would you say amen if you agree with that? Amen. Amen. But that isn't going to happen without my time when I'm going to the grocery store. Hey, Jubilee, why don't you come on with Daddy today and let's practice a new song about Jesus while we go. You know what? That'll have a payoff in 5 years. Even if other stuff washes out, that will matter in 5 years. But there's a second question we got to ask. It's almost like the first one, except it probes even deeper. And that question is, what will it matter in eternity? We've already seen that we get one short life. It is soon going to be passed. And it's only what we're doing for the Lord Jesus Christ that is going to last. We're never a fool when we invest our time, which we can't keep anyway, by exchanging it for an eternal treasure that we'll never lose. Let me show you how most people think about their time. I have a 50-foot rope here that I've stretched out across the platform. And right here on the end of it, there's a little section of black electrical tape. Now, I want you to think of this black electrical tape as your time in this world. And the other 50 feet extends all the way through the wall. It goes out into infinity. But just for the purposes of illustration today, let's pretend that the rope is eternity. The tape is time. You know what most people are thinking? Let's say you're the 35-year-old we were talking about earlier. You'd be right there where my index finger is. They're thinking about as far as my middle finger, maybe about 5 years at the most into the future is all they're actively planning for. And yet, out here, you're going to be on the rope a lot longer than you're going to be on the tape. Am I right about that? And so how do we invest out here on the rope instead of just the tape? Well, there are three and only three ways that we can invest our time that will matter in eternity. They are God, His Word, and people. And the challenge I want to try to leave with you today is this. Screen every activity that comes your way through that question. Does it relate to God, His Word, or people? And if it doesn't directly relate to one of those three, it's only good for the tape. It's not good for the rope. And those three things are the only things that will matter when this life is over and we're in eternity. So live for the rope, not just the tape. Amen? Amen. Let me give you one more idea on how to redeem the time. And that is, we got to tackle number one time waster of all, which is procrastination. Procrastination. Somebody hit the space bar back for me. There for me if you can. There we go. Thank you. Procrastination is the number one instrument that the devil is using in our day. Number one, to keep lost people lost by convincing them it's okay, you got more time. But secondly, to keep you and I from effectively serving God by convincing us that there'll be another time a little further down the road, and that's when I'll really get busy for God. That's when I'll really start serving the Lord. That's when I'll... And meanwhile, life is just passing us by while we're waiting on life to begin. But there is a way we can break that cycle of procrastination, a way we can take hold and redeem the time. And I'll close with it right now. It is what I call the real key to redeeming the time. It's a simple little tactic that, if you remember nothing else I've said today, try your best to take this one thought home with you, because it'll do more than anything else I can share with you to help you redeem the time. Again, it's a question that we want to learn to continually ask. And that question goes like this. There we go. What does God want me to do right now? What does God want me to do right now? What does God want me to do right now? I said it three times so we'd hear it and remember it, because it's just a little different way of saying Proverbs 3:6, where God says, in all your ways, acknowledge me. That means in everything you do, you're looking for a way to make Jesus Christ known. That's what it is to acknowledge him, to make him known. Let's say you're driving to work tomorrow. You get caught in some traffic. Instead of getting angry about it, look back to God and say, God, what do you want me to do right now? Maybe God would put somebody on your heart that needed prayer at that moment. And your prayer could be the key to changing their situation. I think that can happen, don't you? Sure. Or let's say you're coming home from work. You stop by the store. You're paying for your things, and you think, what does God want me to do right now? Oh, ma'am. And by the way, there's a little something you might like to read. I go to the Calvary Church right around the corner here. Come visit sometime. That didn't take any longer than it took to talk about the weather, but it might make a difference in where that person spends eternity. I became a Christian in part because somebody gave me a little gospel tract when I was about 12 years old that started me thinking, eventually led me to those fellows I told you about earlier at the InterVarsity meeting. What does God want me to do right now? Let me give you something to help you remember that. Take out the envelope you had in your hand a moment ago. This time, open the envelope up, look inside the envelope, as I got a little gift for you there. It's a sticker that says, what does God want me to do right now? I'm going to encourage you to take that sticker home with you, put it in a permanent location, your refrigerator door, your bathroom mirror, put it on the back of your phone, just put it where you'll see it often, be reminded to ask that question, what does God want me to do right now? Amen? Amen. Thank you for your excellent attention this morning. I'm going to have a word of prayer to close out, and then I think I'll have about 1 minute left after that to give you a few closing instructions on your material. So let's pray, and then I'll just have a few quick instructions for you. Dear Jesus, thank you for your word, the power of your word that tells us to redeem the time and shows us how to do it. I pray now, Lord, that you would take the thoughts we've shared today and help us to apply them to our lives. Show us specific applications, and I pray most of all that if there's anyone here who's never been redeemed, that before they leave this building today, they can make peace with God and be genuinely redeemed for Jesus' sake. Amen. When you prepare to leave today, make sure you take with you the completed worksheet. This piece of paper that you've been taking your notes on has scripture references on it. Look them up in the next 24 hours. These concepts will stick with you a whole lot better if you do, and so use those during your devotions. There's a second piece of paper I'll draw your attention to. It says, do you know anybody else that might like what we do? If so, just fill this out on your way out, hand it in to me, and I will reward you by giving you a CD collection of our one-minute radio programs that Pastor mentioned earlier. You hear it locally here, but you can get a several hundred on a CD and listen to those as you're driving to work as a way of saying thank you for filling out that piece of paper. Remember to turn the envelope in if you want to get the free book, Learn How to Wake Up and Get Up. Now, the rest of the material, feel free to take it home with you. That's what it's for. If you don't care for it, leave it there on the seat. We'll pick them up after everybody's gone. If you borrowed one of our little yellow pencils, just leave that on the seat because I had to play a lot of golf to get that many little yellow pencils, okay? So leave that there for me to use at my next meeting. And the last thing is there are some resources available on the table as you exit today. Everything is on a donation basis, no set prices on them, but we do have a couple of books back there. My wife's book, 70 Time-Saving Tips for Busy Moms. That might be helpful for some of these ladies around here. And my own book called Morning Momentum, Learning How to Wake Up and Get Up God's Way. Those will be available after the meeting on the book table back there. Pastor, I am done. Thank you so much for allowing me to share.
Thank you, Rick. Now, as you know, the hardest part of any time that we've been motivated is to maintain momentum with application. So it is still up to you as to what you're going to do to make the most of the time. I'm going to have a word of prayer because tomorrow, Andrew and Sarah McCune, sitting right here, Andrew and Mariah, boy, where'd that come? Remember Andrew and Sarah Miller from way back when in our, that was an oldie. Andrew and Mariah tomorrow are going to have their baby. She's going to at least be induced, so we want it to happen tomorrow. So would you be praying for them? And if you're sitting right there by them, Randy and Marlene or Amy, they're going to pray with them, but we're going to bow in a word of prayer and pray for them. And know that they're also celebrating your anniversary today, isn't it? Your first anniversary? Amen. Today. Hallelujah. So let's pray, and then we're going to stand and close in a song. Father, we thank you for this incredible privilege we've had today to be blessed with your servant Rick and his family, and his challenge to us that
maybe parts of it were kind of depressing. I've only got 5 years left. Man, what am I going to do with that time? What am I going to do with every day? And Andrew and Mariah have just begun their family, and baby coming into their life here tomorrow or the next day. More years of marriage they're looking forward to, but nothing is guaranteed. Nothing is guaranteed. What are we doing with today? To lay up treasures for ourselves in heaven where nothing can destroy them. You redeemed us for an eternal purpose, not to make the most of this life, but to make the most of your life, which is eternal. We just pray, Lord Jesus, for the application of that in our lives every day. And we thank you for this privilege in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand.
Sing this up. Living for Jesus, a life that is true, striving to please Him in all that I do, yielding allegiance, glad hearted and free. This is the pathway of blessing for me. Oh, Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to Thee, for Thou in Thy atonement didst give Thyself for me. I owe no other master, my heart shall be Thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for Thee.
Sing one more verse to that. Living for Jesus.
Living for Jesus, who died in my place, bearing on Calvary my sin and disgrace. Such love constrains me to answer His call.
That's our prayer as we prepare to leave now, to go into the world and to use your time. We like to think it's our time, but Father, it's your time. It's always been your time. We're just lucky to have it. So Father, help us use it for your glory, as this song says, to live for you, a life that is true in front of everyone that we are, to show Christ to the people around us for eternity's sake, not just our life's sake. Father, I was praying with my kids the other night. We talked about the things we like, the things we don't like, just the fun stuff. And we talked about all the things we'll get to do in heaven. And the things that we have that we won't be able to take with us. They'll all be burned up. But we live for those things. We try to get those things. We try to have those things and do those things. But the only thing that we can take, I asked the question. The question was in my head. The only thing that we can take with us to heaven, that's the other souls that are around us. They're the only thing that we can lay at the feet of Jesus and say, Father, here. So my son said, hey, Dad, guess what the most important thing we need to do is? The souls. Get the souls. That's what he said. And I said, son, you're right. And one day we get to lay the crowns and those things at the feet of Jesus and say, here, for you and you alone. We live our lives for you, Father. Help us do that. It's hard. It's so hard. But with your strength, Father, with you right there helping us, man, help us shine your light to the world. And everyone says, amen. You're dismissed. Love you guys.
Well, I hope that you feel as refreshed as I do after studying God's Word. You know, this is a worldwide ministry that God has given us to be able to reach out with the gospel of Jesus Christ all over the world. And He has been incredibly gracious and generous to us. He supplies all of our needs according to His riches in glory, and we love being generous. And we would like to invite you to experience the joy of generosity as well. You know, if God is using this ministry to bless you in some way, we would like to invite you to respond with generous thanksgiving. So on our website or on our Calvary app for your mobile device that's available at your app store, there's a link to our online giving. And we would just pray that as the Lord leads you and blesses you, that you consider being a blessing to us in supplying the needs we have for this growing worldwide ministry. Now, I want to bless you from the Word of God. May grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. May the Lord direct your hearts to the love of God and to the steadfastness of Christ. And may the God of peace Himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Be blessed and be a blessing as you serve Jesus with your whole heart.